Hey guys, this is Haku, and I am bringing you Chapter 14 in Ninja Gaiden Sigma Plus on Hard Mode. This is another chapter that solely is involving Rachel. The initial part of the chapter, as you walk out here, you're faced with a new mob that is the Soldier Fiend. So the soldiers that were in Tyrone have all been turned into fiends. They still have all of their techniques that they had as soldiers, plus some additional ones. You still have to worry about the grab and stab technique that is unavoidable damage. Coupled with that, you now also have to worry about a fireball technique that they will launch at you, and additional melee combos plus jump techniques that can all block break you. To the left, you can break down a door that Ryu could not initially break down with any of his non-quote-unquote heavy weapons. However, Rachel does not have the jumping ability to get to the higher ledges in order to gain the treasure chests that are located up top. A quick way to deal with the initial set of three fiends is to just use the blades of the Ouroboros and then walk into this room, grab the treasure chest, and have your Nimpo refilled. Throughout this chapter, you will be backtracking through some familiar locations, coupled with going to new dimensional locations, as was mentioned in the pre-chapter, the epilogue. So, indeed. Right now, we are in the Ninja Village, specifically the Ninja Graveyard. So, all of, Ryu's comrades are buried here, and ancestors, etc. There is a fiend challenge on the bridge where you faced the second chapter boss, the Fiery Samurai. This particular fiend challenge involves the highly upgraded version of the samurai. These particular samurai have a very large amount of HP. Coupled with that, they also have two different forms of a melee combo. The first form of the melee combo, only the first hit is actually counterable. So you can either counter the first hit, or you have to roll away from the next two and avoid them, as they are both block breaks. The second melee combo starts with an upward slash, and then from there, if it successfully lands, he can continue to chain from it. However, you should just immediately roll back if you are ever hit by this, as again, the upward slash is not counterable. The actual amount of techniques on the samurai that you can successfully counter are very low, so it creates a small frustration in dealing with them. Coupled with that, if they are not currently in an active melee technique, Rachel cannot do any of her rolls over them. This means that if you ever get backed into a corner, you don't have any possible safe escape other than using Nimpo. So it's quite difficult to actually escape, especially when you have two samurais on you, chaining melee techniques and block breaks together. Coupled with that, you also have the sorcerers in the area, and the sorcerers in the area will basically chain non-stop either their melee technique, if you're close to their melee range, or they will use their version of Nimpo and hit you and juggle you in combination with the samurai. It's best to approach this fight the same way that just about every fiend challenge is approached. You want to try to keep as many active essence in the area as you possibly can, so that way you can continually use either level 1 or level 2 ults. You want to be continually landing the level 1 and level 2 ults on two or more of the mobs. The reason for that is, you want to get two essence, absorb those two essence so you get a level 2 ult, and then fire off that level 2 ult for maximum karma, coupled with that maximum points and profits in the timed calculator for each fight. Again, like I've mentioned in other videos, every single encounter in the game, including fiend challenges, including boss fights, including, well, just about everything, has a time limit on them. And then during that time limit, every level 1 ult nets you 2,000 essence, and every level 2 ult nets you 5,000 essence. Well, I mean not essence, but karma, rather. So you absorb essence and get money from it, but coupled with that, you also get karma for each successful ult that you land. And this is just calculated and totaled into your end-of-chapter bonus. In that particular moment right there, you could see I was continually trying to roll over the soldier, and every time I tried to roll over the soldier, he just did a simple melee block, and I wasn't able to move it. So I just kept getting shoved further and further back into a corner. Once you've killed off all of the melee samurai, it is much easier to deal with the fiend challenge. The amount of things that you have to watch out for, of course, lowers significantly. And then coupled with that, the sorcerers are nowhere near as scary as they are with multiple mobs surrounding them. There, as you can see, it is quite easy to get juggled. One samurai can land a melee combo, then this next samurai will start his melee combo, and then after that, the sorcerer will hit you with either their ninpo or their melee combo. So it's just a huge juggle chain that you have to be very cautious of. However, countering the sorcerer is quite easy to do. All of the sorcerer's melee techniques are not block breaks. So meaning if you understand the timing and understand the teleportation, you can very easily counter them and kill them quite quickly. When you land a simple melee counter on the sorcerer, you should follow up with a forward power technique in order to finish them off. They actually won't die from just a simple melee counter, so that's why it's best to, as they fall to the ground, be moving towards them, so that way you're already set up for a forward power technique, and then just take them out from there. And of course, what I mean by a forward power technique is just having the direction button pointed towards the mob that you want to hit, and then use triangle. With Rachel, it typically elicits her just forward single slash with the Warhammer. That forward single slash is her single most powerful hit. There are combos that she has that are more powerful, but in terms of single hits, that is the most powerful technique. Whenever they land or finish one of their melee combos, the sorcerers, you do have a period of time where they are open that you can land a normal melee hit on them. Now that all of the melee soldiers are gone, you can either choose to use essence and chain each essence that the sorcerer drops in order to kill the next, or simply use counters and melee techniques in order to kill them. I recommend using counters and melee techniques because of the sorcerer's teleportation ability. There you can see, even if you do successfully charge and land an ult, there is a very high chance that the sorcerer will either teleport away and gain immunity, or there's also a chance that you can be knocked out of it by their quick melee combos. It comes down to your timing and being able to understand when they are open and when they will teleport. Typically, their teleportation will happen after a short rest period after a melee combo. So you either have to get your timings perfect to start your hits right as their melee combo lands, or they will simply teleport away. The game, in many cases, a perfect example is the sorcerers, uses sounds as cues. With the sorcerer's ninpo technique, you can hear when they're about to cast it. So the best idea is to just roll out of the way after a certain auditory cue is heard. They will begin casting it, and then there's a wait time where they will be actively tracking either Ryu or Rachel with that technique. But after that track time has expired, you can roll and the projectiles will just move straight past you. So it's best to notice what is the proper time to roll and what is the proper time to move. If you actually roll directly at them and time it perfectly, your roll invincibility period will allow you to completely avoid the projectiles. Even if you land or attempt to land an aerial combo, it still is quite difficult to successfully hit the sorcerers without them teleporting. Here you can see that the last part of the Fiend Challenge is 6 Black Spider Ninja. These Black Spider Ninja are much more difficult to deal with as Rachel than they are with Ryu. With Ryu, you can simply use the Izuna drop in order to kill them in basically one hit. However, the moment Rachel lands with a landing ult, that is typically when they are throwing their incendiary shuriken. So there you can see, I landed, I instant charged with the essence, but because their incendiary shuriken was fired at the exact same time that I landed, I was unable to successfully get the ult off. That's one of the major frustrations with this fight, is their high amount of interruptions. They attack very quickly and use a lot of techniques that by themselves don't do a lot of damage, but when there are three of them in conjunction with each other, constantly firing at you, constantly using different techniques that are meant to simply interrupt you, it makes the ending part of the fight quite difficult. You can see, as a reward, we get the Spirit of the Devils. This is the exact same thing for Rachel as it is for Ryu. It simply increases the maximum amount of Nimpo that you can be carrying at a time. Since Rachel has had so many Fiend challenges, in essentially every single chapter that she's been in, she's rich. She's absolutely rich. So, buy everything. Especially all of the earrings. Just like Ryu and his armlet, Rachel has all of the same types of earrings, and these earrings can be equipped to have the same types of effects that they have on Ryu. So, pick whatever earring suits your playstyle best, and then use it to just gain a profit. I prefer, just like with Ryu, to use the earrings of the sun, or the armlet of the sun, because in many cases, there are enemies that only have less than a second period of time where they are open and allow for damage. I would much rather be able to land as much damage as I possibly can during that very small limited amount of time than anything else. There you can see that getting trapped in the corner is really bad with these particular mobs. Once you're in a corner, it's quite difficult to get out it's unless they stop their particular melee chain. But in most cases, once they're in your face like that, they will continue to just chain melee techniques on you while you can't escape. And you end up taking a lot of damage because most of it is a block break followed by a heavy damage technique. Thankfully, there are very few amount of mobs in this particular spawn area that you have to deal with. This chapter covers a very short amount of actual distance, but the amount of creatures that you have to face in the chapter makes it feel much longer. After that spawn sequence, you have to deal with a small amount of sorcerers by themselves. Again, once the sorcerer is by himself, they are quite easy to deal with. Simply use counters and melee combos when they are open to quickly and effectively take them out. There are Muramasa shops everywhere, so we just passed one and then we just passed another. In order to progress to the last part of the chapter, Rachel needs to go to the stone that Ryu was unable to break in the earlier chapters because Ryu did not have access to any heavy weapons. Behind the stone will be a complete form of the ancient stone tablet that Ryu has been slowly collecting throughout his adventures. So Rachel will actually have a complete form of that tablet and be able to take advantage of the teleportation that it grants. Again, mobs in every single area in this chapter. There's no break room, there's no breathing room, Every new area and every sequence that you experience in this chapter has many and multiple mobs. Here you can see the mysterious stone tablet, and in order to progress to the next area, you place the stone tablet in the stone altar located right there. You have to deal with a couple sorcerers really quickly. After you've dealt with them, you place the tablet in, you get teleported to a very small, enclosed area where there will be another mini fiend challenge awaiting Rachel. This next fiend challenge comes in two parts. The first part involves the blue-haired fiends that we've been dealing with throughout basically the entire game. And the second part deals with the dinosaurs that are seen in Chapter 12 in the Peristyle Passage with Ryu. Dealing with them as Rachel is quite a bit more difficult than with Ryu, as dodging and moving away from their techniques once their mask is broken off is significantly more difficult as Rachel than it is with Ryu. Dealing with the blue fiends, simply use landing ults the same way that we've been dealing with just about every fiend challenge so far. These fiends have quite a few more counterable techniques, which makes dealing with them significantly less frustrating than dealing with the upgraded forms of the samurai. It seems like those samurai seriously have so much HP, and it's quite difficult to kill them off without using a level 1 or level 2 ult. So, after this fiend dies, the first part of this particular fiend challenge ends, and then we are greeted with the second part. As you can see, one of the dinosaurs from the Peristyle Passage pops up, and additional blue fiends spawn. The dinosaur should be mostly ignored, however, try to keep him within your peripherals. His range is so long that you may think that, you know, you're far enough away from him, but he just takes one or two steps forward, and then suddenly you're getting owned by a giant mace. And that's definitely, definitely not what we want. Deal with the fiends, and then use landing ults in order to take off HP from the dinosaur, and then also use landing ults in order to kill as many of the fiends as you possibly can. If you can successfully land two level 1 or level 2 ults on the boss, not the boss, but the dinosaur, it should take him out very quickly. Next, you are teleported into the final area of the chapter, where you meet up with Doku. And unfortunately, Doku puts you into a fight that is quite unfair. Rachel does not have the agility or the immunity periods to be able to deal with these two greater fiends. So it's Rachel versus a fiend that basically mimics Alma in every way, shape, and form. That is the one that is firing the yellow projectiles at the moment. Just think Alma fight. That fiend does exactly the same things as Alma in every way, shape, and form. Then we have the second fiend, the blue fiend. The blue fiend has quite a few interesting techniques. She has a whip hand, and that whip will mostly be used for melee techniques and grabs, but coupled with that, that whip can also be used to grab the sides of the outside area of this location, and she can spin around with it. Coupled with that, she can also fire a laser cannon in a forward conal effect that does heavy, heavy damage. In order to have a chance at all to survive in this fight, wall jump techniques coupled with power techniques in the air should be used. It's the most effective way to gain consistent amounts of immunity and actually allows you to damage the bosses. Unfortunately yet, I have not been able to kill both of the bosses with Rachel. I've done it in the fiend challenge with Ryu. However, Rachel is so much slower and so much weaker without the unlabored flawlessness that the fight is much more difficult. This fight, just like the Doku fight at the beginning of the game, is not intended to actually be won. It's just meant to be, you know, a kind of challenge that, you know, if you can beat it, well, all the power to you. That means you're freaking amazing. As you can see, the One Fiend literally mimics Alma in every way, shape, and form. So it's like fighting Alma with another version of Alma that's just as powerful. So it's a very difficult fight. When Rachel's HP hits zero, she falls to the ground, Doku comes in and claims her. This chapter was mostly meant to resolve a lot of the open-ended questions that were in the original Ninja Gaiden. So here we actually see how Rachel was recaptured. Anyway, that was chapter 14, guys. Thanks for watching. I appreciate it. Ciao for now.